l'état. So basically, when you translated that directly, we're talking about moods and tenses. So basically, like in English, if you want to use a verb, and normally when you will use a verb, you will have to basically decide whether you are using a certain mood and also whether you are using a certain tense for this verb, just because the moods and the tenses will be used in specific context or situations. Okay, so let's see now les modes. Okay, and basically in French we've got the first one that we will see together in the coming lessons will be l'indicatif. Okay, and l'indicatif is used to express the reality, so what is really happening. Then we'll have le conditionnel. Okay, so basically, like in English, we will use it to express what we call l'éventualité, something that might happen. Okay, and then we'll have this imperative form as well. So imperative mood, sorry, just to express l'ordre, the order, or then le conseil, advice. And then we'll have this subjonctif, which can be quite tricky, especially at the beginning, because it doesn't exist really in English, and it's to express what we call le sentiment. Okay, so basically we'll have these main moods, so l'indicatif, le conditionnel, l'impératif, and then le subjonctif. It does mean that in all these moods, dans toutes ces modes, you will have different tenses as well. Okay, and that's what we are going to see next, because basically when we're talking about les temps, the tenses, well, I will make it simple, okay, and we'll see in the coming or in the next videos how it will work. But mainly you will express three things with these tenses, and the first one is le présent, okay, the present, then le futur, the future, and then le passé, the past. And we will see that for all these three options, we will have different ways of expressing them. So it does mean that we will have not only three tenses, but much more. Okay, no stress about that, don't worry, we'll do it little by little. So, but just to keep in mind that when we're talking about the tenses, well, we express normally le présent, le futur, and then le passé. Okay, so keep in mind that we get les modes. Okay, so le mode, and you get to decide what mode or what mood, sorry, you will have to use. Indicatif, conditionnel, impératif, or then subjonctif. And the second thing that you have to choose is the correct tense, le temps, and then it's présent, futur, and passé. And keep in mind that, as I said, we've got quite many tenses, but we'll see that a bit later. Les signes diacritiques. And I know that the title is quite scary, and you probably think that, oh, I don't want to watch this video. But trust me, it's quite important for a good reason. And well, basically, what is les signes diacritiques? It's the idea that at one point in the language, we will use un signe, a sign, something that you will add to a letter, and by adding this sign to the letter, it will make a new letter. Okay, and something quite common in French, and we'll see exactly what we are talking about, because even if it's scary, the good news is that we've got only cinq signes diacritiques. And the first one is accent aigu. Okay, the second one is accent grave. Third one is accent circumflex, then tréma, and last but not least, cédille. Okay, so accent aigu, accent grave, accent circumflex, tréma, and then cédille. So let's start with l'accent aigu, and it basically, it looks like that. Okay, so this is l'accent aigu, and let's see, you will actually put l'accent aigu on the top of E. Okay, it doesn't come on the top of A, I, O, U, Y, it's only on E. Okay, so keep in mind that l'accent aigu is only coming right here on the top of E. Okay, then you will have l'accent grave, and it goes in the other direction. Okay, but then l'accent grave is actually more used because you can put it on the top of A, on the top of E, and then on the top of U. All right. After that, you've got l'accent circonflex. So it's like a little roof here, like a little hat. And it will come on the top of A, E, I, O, and U. Then tréma, just like two little dots here. And it will come on the top of A, E, I, O, and then U. Okay, and the last one, la cédille, if you look carefully, basically, it will come right below your C letter. Okay? So remember, l'accent aigu, l'accent grave, l'accent circonflexe, le tréma, la cédille. All right. And the idea, of course, in this video, is only to present these five signs. So in the next lessons, in the next units, I will focus on explaining how to pronounce them, because, of course, the pronunciation will change. If you put l'accent aigu on the top of E, basically you won't pronounce it like you would pronounce it without the accent. Okay? But then keep in mind that we've got these five signes diacritiques. Accent aigu, accent grave, accent circonflexe, tréma, cédille. Les ligatures. So even if it's a bit scary, let's start the video. And basically, what are we talking about when we're talking about les ligatures? Well, we're talking about two letters, some strange letters, you might say. This is the first one, and this is the second one. They are quite rare in the French language, but basically you can see them and you need to know what they are, and that's the reason why I've been making this little video. So the first one is this E dans la. Okay, so basically if you translate directly, it's inside or in A, and that's the reason why, because if you look carefully, it's only one letter here, and like if these two letters were glued, okay, or connected like that. So it's E dans la. Let's see a few examples of words that use this E dans la. And the first one is curriculum vitae. The second one is ex aequo. Then etc. And then ad vitam aeternam. And so if you look carefully at these words, you realize that this letter is coming directly from Latin. Okay, so and it's quite rare to see this letter in French language. Well, you've got here some examples, but I've been choosing the more common examples, because the other one probably you will never use them, or maybe never encounter them. But anyway, it is rare, but it does exist, and it can be a challenge in some cases for some of you to write this letter correctly. If you want to write it with your computer, because you've got to go through insert and then after that symbol. So basically, it's up to you. If you want to write it correctly, you should put, of course, this E dans la. If you don't manage to put it, then just put A and after E. Maybe your computer will correct it automatically. You never know. Okay. The second one is this one, and it's E dans l'eau. So basically, the same concept. So E inside O. All right, so because it's only one letter here, and you get this O and E connected, like glued, okay, to each other. So let's see, because this one is actually used a bit more often, and I've been selecting few words. And the first one is un bœuf, un cœur. It's actually quite interesting, because even if you write them differently, you pronounce them the same way. Un œil, un œuf, une sœur. Okay, so un bœuf, un cœur, un œil, un œuf, une sœur. All right, so these words are actually not that rare, and we'll see exactly what they mean. The first one, un bœuf, okay, steer, ox, or then un cœur, heart, un œuf, egg, un cœur, is it choir, choir? I'm not really sure about the pronunciation in English, sorry about that, I don't want to make any mistake. Then we've got un œil, eye, and then une sœur, sister. Okay, and this letter is actually more often used, okay, than the previous one. And then it's, well, basically it will be exactly the same challenge if you want to write it correctly with your computer, whether you try to find this letter by inserting a symbol, okay, or then you just put O, and then after that you will put E, okay. Technically, it's a mistake, but then basically, if you cannot make in another way, then just write it O and E, okay? Le masculin et le féminin, so the masculine and the feminine. And actually, in French, when it comes to grammar, we've got the difference between the masculine form and the feminine form, and we'll see that it will affect quite deeply the language. For instance, we've got, when it comes to les pronoms personnels, we'll have the difference between the masculine and the feminine. So we'll start with the feminine, ladies first, and it's elle, okay? So she, so in that case, it is the feminine singular form, elle, okay? For the masculine, it will be il. So in English, it will be he, okay? Il, so in that case, it's the masculine singular form. When it comes to the plural, actually in French, we also have the difference between the feminine and the masculine. So basically here, elle, it's the feminine plural form. Okay, and then in the same way here, il will be the masculine plural form. So if you look carefully, the only difference between the singular and the plural, it's this final S here. Same thing here between il and il, it's the final S. And if you listen carefully, basically you don't have any differences. So it's elle and elle, il and il. Okay, the grammar rule is quite strict in French. If you've got a group of persons and in this group you've got at least one man, it will be masculine. Okay, so let's see now if you discover a new word. Okay, so it could be a noun, it could be an adjective. In that case, the good reflex would be to try to see and to try to remember whether it's feminine or whether it's masculine, okay? Because it will basically affect after that, and we'll see that in this video, what will come after. And in most of the cases, we're talking about the adjectives, okay? So it's always good to remember the gender of a word, okay? Of course, in that case, if you're encountering a new noun, so basically you try to remember the gender at the same time. I will make some videos covering the topic and that giving you a few tips to try to see, you know, whether it's masculine or feminine according to the ending of the word. In some cases it can help, but in most of the cases you will have to remember the gender. Just when you discover a new word, try to remember the gender at the same time. Okay, so for a good reason, and this is now what I will explain it. Well, basically, when you've got a noun, it will actually be connected to an adjective, and whether it's masculine or feminine, basically in French the adjective will be changed also. So let's see an example here. We've got un pays chaud. So if we translate directly, it's un pays, it's a country, and it's chaud is warm, hot. Okay, un pays chaud. So you can see that here pays is masculine, un is the article, the masculine article, un pays chaud, and in that case your adjective is like that, written at the basic form. So the masculine form is the basic form. And if we take another word like boisson, boisson is feminine, une boisson. Okay, so here you've got the article, and it's the feminine form of the article, une boisson. And you can see that here your adjective is changing. You will have to put this final e, chaude, okay, at the end. And then the pronunciation will change a little bit. Chaude. So here you pronounce the final d, whereas in the masculine form, you don't pronounce it. Okay, all right, so it's just an introduction, don't worry. In the coming videos, I will explain everything. So the articles, the adjective, the way to put the feminine form, everything. So in this video, it's just to show you that basically the masculine and the feminine, so whether it's a noun at the masculine and at the feminine, it will affect the adjective connected to it. Okay, and then it's also actually possible that the noun, or as we saw, le pronom personnel, will affect the verb. We are talking in that case about what we call compound tenses. So we will cover that probably in unit 4, 5, or 6. Have a look there. We're talking about le passé composé, for instance, so the past tense. And basically, let's have a look there. You will have il est allé. Okay, it's the masculine form here. So, aller is to go. And this is the compound tense of il est allé. All right. And then you will have here, elle est allée. So, basically, he went, she went. All right. And here you can see that you will have the difference between the masculine and the feminine. But don't worry about that, because I will explain that later. It's just to show you that basically the difference between the masculine and the feminine will concern, of course, the subject, so pronom personnel, and then the nouns, but it will also affect what is coming after. So it can be an adjective, as we saw, or it can be a verb. In that case, it's a compound tense, so it's this past tense, le passé composé. All right. So no stress about that. I will explain everything after. Okay. Just keep in mind that we've got a difference between the masculine and the feminine. And so my tip for this video will be when you discover a new word, as I said, try to remember whether it's masculine or feminine here or masculine. Okay. Merci beaucoup. Oui et non. Oui et non. So basically, yes and no. Oui et non. So because I thought, you know, it might be useful to make this video. In some situations, I've been assuming that people would understand and would know how to use oui et non, but it's not always the case. And well, basically, I don't expect them to do that. And as I am doing this video and this series of videos for beginners and total beginners, then this is the reason why I thought it might be useful to introduce oui, yes, and then non, no. So basically, when you have a question here, well, in French, you can answer with oui, yes, or then with non, no. It might seem simple, but it's just the way it is. And let's make it quite clear. And that's the reason why we have this question. Vous parlez français? Okay. Basically, do you speak French? I just put that in that order because normally it should be verb first and after the subject if we want to construct a correct question. But in many situations, especially when we talk, we can keep the same order. We just need to raise the voice at the end. So of course, l'Académie Française would like me to put them in the other order, but basically you will hear many French people and many French-speaking people just keep the same order and raise their voice at the end. Okay, vous parlez français? So basically it's a question, do you speak French? And in that case, you've got, well, two possible answers. And if you want to actually answer in a short way, the first option would be oui or then non. Of course, at one point, and that's the reason why we'll have these videos, you will have the possibility to construct sentences. But basically, if you want to answer shortly, it's not rude. It's quite just you just show that you don't really want to talk that much, but basically you just answer to the question. So oui, yes, and then non, no. Let's see now how it will work if we have a question, but if this question is at the negative form, okay? Because in that case, it's somehow a bit tricky because strangely for the affirmative answer, it won't be oui, but it will become si. And then for the negative, it will be exactly the same. It will be non. Okay, so keep in mind if you get a question, but then this question is at the negative form, then instead of using oui, you will use si, but then non will be the same. Okay, so let's see the same question. Vous ne parlez pas français? So you don't speak French, okay? So this is how it works for the negative form. Don't worry, in few videos, I will explain you how it works exactly, okay? But at this point, it's only to introduce oui, non, si, non, okay? So it's a negative question in that case. You don't speak French? And the answer would be si, or then non. Obviously, at one point, you would like to make sentences instead of using these two possibilities, okay? But it's just to show you that, you know, actually, you've got these two options. So if you've got a question, the first one would be oui or then non. If it's a negative question, then it will be si or non, okay? La ponctuation. So let's discover together the punctuation in French. Okay, so we can start. And I thought it might be useful to start with this one, and it's le point. Okay, so le point. And for this video, I will actually tell you how to put these punctuation signs and if we need to put some spaces or not, because it does change a little bit if you compare it to English, for instance. So let's see now, le point. So let's imagine that you will have your sentence, or it could be a word like that. And after that, you will put le point. Then you will have to put a space and the next word will come. Okay, so it could be a sentence before, a sentence after, but the main thing is to remember that you don't have any space before, but you will have one after. Okay, so let's see now the next one, and it's le point virgule. Okay, le point virgule works like that, mot numéro un. Then you will put, le point virgule without any space, then a space and the next word or the rest of the sentence. Okay. La virgule. Okay, so la virgule. And for la virgule, actually, you will have the first word. Then la virgule is coming without any space. Then you will put a space and the rest of the sentence or the next word is coming after. Okay, nothing before, one space after. Le point d'interrogation. Le point d'interrogation. Okay, and in that case, keep in mind that you will have whether your sentence or this word, then, and this is quite important because it does change from other languages, you put a space, you put le point d'interrogation, okay? Then after that, a space, and the rest will follow, okay? So this is quite important. Remember that we will put in French a space before le point d'interrogation, because it's not the case in, well, some other languages, okay? And now, le point d'exclamation. Okay, so le point d'exclamation, you will have your sentence and then the previous word. Then, an espace, space. Then, you will put your point d'exclamation here. After that, a space, and the next word is coming. Same thing as we had for le point d'interrogation. Remember that you will have to put a space before. Les deux points. Okay, les deux points. And then they work like that. Le mot. Then you will have to put space. Les deux points are coming right after, another space after, then the rest will come. Okay, so remember, one space before, one space after. Les guillemets. Okay, les guillemets. And concerning les guillemets, actually, it will go like that. So you will have your sentence or, well, the previous word, then a space, then the first one. After that, a space, then you put what you want to put between them. Another space, guillemets again, space, and the rest of the sentence or the next word or whatever you want here. But you've got to keep in mind that here it's quite tricky. Space, then guillemets, space, what you put between, space, guillemets, space, and what comes after. Les points de suspension. Les points de suspension. And regarding les points de suspension, it will come like that. So what comes before, le mot, or then the sentence, and then les points de suspension, space, and then the next word, or what comes after the sentence, if you want. Okay, so nothing before, a space after. Les parenthèses, okay, and regarding les parenthèses, well, the first word, then you will put a space, then the first part, so la première parenthèse, your word, or then group of words, fermez la parenthèse, then you will put a space, and after that, the next part is coming. Okay, so remember, before and after, nothing between. Okay? Écrire en français. So, write in French. And, well, I thought it might be useful to make this little video because I've been teaching for quite many years now, and I've been noticing that at one point my students tend to be a bit disappointed or sad because they just realized one important thing in French, and it's the difference between what je prononce, I pronounce, and j'écris, I write. Because basically you can see that, of course, you will have some connections between what you pronounce and what you write, but we've got many, many things that we will have to write and we won't pronounce. I thought it might be useful to start and give you an example here with the verb parler. Okay, so we will make the conjugation. Remember that we will focus on the conjugation in another video that will come a bit later. Okay, but it's just to give you a good example here. So parler is to speak or to talk, and it's a regular verb, so it belongs to the first group ending with er. So let's see how we conjugate it at the present tense. Je parle. Tu parles, il, elle parle, nous parlons, vous parlez, il, elle parle. Okay, so basically you get here this je, and it's I. Je parle, I talk, I speak. Tu, and tu is for you, okay, and it's the singular form. Tu parles, here, you talk, you speak. Il, it's for the masculine form, he, il, and then elle, feminine form, she, elle. Okay, so il, elle, and then we've got the same form, parle. Then comes the plural form, nous, so oui, okay, and in that case it's nous parlons, vous, you, so it's the plural form, or then we'll see a bit later that it can be also for the singular if it's the polite form. Okay, vous parlez, and then we've got il, so they, but then in French we divide and we make the difference between the masculine plural, so il here, and elle, the feminine plural, il, elle parle. All right, so we get je parle, tu parles, il parle, elle parle, nous parlons, vous parlez, il parle, elle parle. And if you look carefully, you write it with E here, E-S, E, then you get E-N-T here. So I only take these four forms just for a good reason. It's just because if you look carefully and if you listen to me, I will pronounce it je parle, tu parles, il parle, elle parle, il parle, elle parle. So it does mean that even if you write them differently, E, ES, and then ENT, you will pronounce them the same way. And this is basically the difficult thing about French language. It's just the big difference between what you say, what you pronounce, and what you write, okay? So in this example, for this verb, actually, if we finish it like that, you can see that you've got three phonetical forms. The first one is parle, okay, the yellow one. Then you've got nous parlons, and then you've got vous parlez. But of course, at one point, if you want to write it correctly, you will have to remember the endings, and you will have to put this S here, for instance, if you want to write it correctly, or then ENT here, even if you pronounce them the same way. Okay, so my advice would be, if you want to be happy, well, basically, when you see, it's coming, yeah, when you see a new word, a nouveau mot, well, word in general, so it can be a verb, it can be an adjective, it can be a noun, whatever. When you see a new word, try to remember, of course, how you will pronounce it, but then try also to remember how to write it correctly.